The cerebral circulation, so anatomy and ultrastructure. So brain, no, it is one of the most highly perfused organs in the body. So brain has got highest perfusion. So it is therefore not surprising that arterial blood supply to the human brain consists of two pairs of large arteries. So it consists of two pairs of large arteries. So the right and left internal carotid, two pairs means totally four. So one is right and left internal carotid and right and left vertebral arteries. So the human brain, it consists of, it's a highly perfused organ and it consists of two pairs of large arteries. So the right and left internal carotid and the right and left vertebral arteries. So the internal carotid arteries, they principally supply the cerebrum. Internal carotid arteries, no, what does they supply? They supply the cerebrum. Internal carotid arteries supply the cerebrum, whereas the two vertebral arteries, they join distally to form the basilar artery. So internal carotid arteries are supplying the cerebrum, two vertebral arteries, so they are joining distally to form the basilar artery. So internal carotid arteries supplying the cerebrum, two vertebral arteries are becoming the basilar artery. So branches of the vertebral and basilar artery, so vertebral artery as well as vertebral arteries are joining to form the basilar artery. So the branches of the vertebral and basilar artery supply blood for the cerebellum and brainstem. So the cerebellum and brainstem is supplied by branches of the vertebral and basilar arteries. Cerebellum and brainstem are supplied by branches of the vertebral and basilar artery. So the proximally the basilar artery, it joins the two internal carotid arteries, and so this basilar artery is joining with the two internal carotid arteries and other communicating arteries to form a complete anastomotic ring. So there is a complete anastomotic ring at the base of the brain. So this is known as the circle of Willis. So this circle of Willis is named after Sir Thomas Willis, who described the arterial circle. So this basilar artery, it is going and joining the two internal carotid arteries and other communicating arteries. So this is forming a complete anastomotic ring at the base of the brain. So this is known as the circle of Willis. So this is named after Sir Thomas Willis, who described the arterial circle. So this is named by Sir Thomas Willis. So circulus arteriosus cerebri. Circulus arteriosus cerebri. So the circle of Willis, it gives rise to three pairs of main arteries. So basilar artery is joining the internal carotid artery. So there is a circulus arteriocerebri at the base of the brain. So this circle of Willis, it gives rise to three pairs of main arteries. So what are these? The anterior, middle and posterior cerebral arteries. So it is giving rise to anterior, middle and posterior cerebral arteries, so which divide into progressively smaller arteries and arterioles. So they run along the surface. So these circle of Willis, it is giving three pairs of main arteries, anterior, middle and posterior cerebral arteries. So they divide into progressively smaller arteries and arteriole that run along the surface until they penetrate the brain tissue to supply blood to the corresponding regions of the cerebral cortex. After that, they'll penetrate the brain tissue to supply blood to the corresponding regions of the cerebral cortex. So this is the diagram showing the, so this is a common carotid artery, so this is giving rise to internal carotid artery, okay, and this is the vertebral artery, okay. So the two vertebral arteries, they join to form the basilar artery, and this is the internal carotid artery, so which is a branch of common carotid artery, and this is the external carotid artery. So in this diagram, so here it is the common carotid artery, so this is the external external carotid artery, this is the cerebral artery, here it is the vertebral artery. So this is the circle of Willis. So in the circle of Willis, here we have this. So this is the circle of Willis. So this is the, so down here it is the, okay, basilar artery. Then we have the middle cerebral artery. We have the anterior cerebral artery, anterior communicating artery, and this is the internal carotid artery, and this is the posterior communicating artery, and we also have the ophthalmic artery, and we also have the anterior choroidal artery. So here we have the superior cerebellar arteries, pontine arteries, and inferior cerebellar arteries. So here we can see the internal carotid artery. Okay, from this internal carotid artery, we have this middle cerebral artery, and we have the anterior cerebral artery. Middle and anterior cerebral artery. So the two anterior cerebral arteries are joined by anterior communicating artery. Then we have the posterior cerebral artery, which is joining to the anterior circulation by posterior communicating artery. Here we have the superior cerebellar artery, and then we have the pontine arteries, we have the basilar artery, and then we have the anterior inferior cerebellar arteries. And then we have the cerebral vascular architecture. So coming to the cerebral vascular architecture, the pial vessels or intracranial vessels on the surface of the brain within the pia arachnoid. So these are also known as the leptomeninges or glia limitans. So the pial vessels means intracranial vessels on the surface of the brain within the pia and arachnoid, also known as the leptomeninges or glia limitans. The outermost layer of the cortex comprised of astrocytic end feet. The pial vessels or intracranial vessels on the surface of the brain, okay, within the pia arachnoid, also known as the leptomeninges or glia limitans. The outermost layer of the cortex is composed of astrocytic. So cortex will be covered by pia matter and arachnoid matter, and then we have the dura matter. So the outermost layer of the cortex, no, it is comprised of astrocytic end feet. So pial vessels are surrounded by CSF and give rise to smaller arteries that eventually penetrate into the brain tissue. So pial vessels, no, they are surrounded by CSF, and these pial vessels, they give rise to smaller arteries, so they eventually penetrate into the brain tissue. So penetrating arterioles lie within the Virchow-Robin space and are structurally between pial and parenchymal arterioles. So penetrating arterioles, no? So they lie within the virtue Robin space, and these are structurally between the pial and parenchymal arterioles. So this virtue Robin space, no? So this is a continuation of the subarachnoid space and varies considerably in depth by species. So virtue Robin space is a continuation of the subarachnoid space and varies considerably in depth. So the penetrating arteries become parenchymal arterioles once they penetrate into the brain tissue and become almost completely surrounded by astrocytic end feet. So penetrating arteries will be there from pial vessels, and after that, once they penetrate the brain parenchyma, so they are called as parenchymal arterioles. Virtue Robin space, nothing but continuation of the subarachnoid space, and varies considerably in depth by species. So there are several important structural and functional differences between pial arteries on the surface of the brain and smaller parenchymal arterioles. Important structural and functional differences between pial arteries on the surface of the brain and smaller. So there are structural and functional differences between the pial arteries on the surface of the brain and smaller parenchymal arterioles. So first, pial arteries, no? They receive perivascular innervation from the peripheral nervous system. So this is also known as extrinsic innervation. Pial arteries on the surface of the brain, they receive perivascular innervation from the peripheral nervous system. So this is also known as extrinsic innervation, whereas parenchymal arterioles are intrinsically innervated from within the brain neuropil. Okay, pial arteries from peripheral nervous system, so that is extrinsic innervation, whereas parenchymal arterioles, no, they are intrinsically innervated from within the brain neutrophil. So while parenchymal arterioles have only one layer of circumferentially oriented smooth muscle, they possess greater basal tone and are unresponsive to at least some neurotransmitters that can have large effects on upstream vessels. Parenchymal arterioles, no, they have only one layer of circumferentially oriented smooth muscle. So the smooth muscle is only one layer in parenchymal arterioles, and these parenchymal arterioles, one layer of smooth muscle, greater basal tone, and unresponsive to at least some neurotransmitters, but these neurotransmitters, they can have large effects on upstream vessels. So what are these neurotransmitters? Serotonin and norepinephrine. Unresponsive. Lastly, pial vessel architecture forms an effective collateral network such that occlusion of one vessel does not appreciably decrease cerebral blood flow. Lastly, no, this pial vessel architecture, no, they forms an effective collateral network. So which forms effective collateral network? The pial vessel architecture forms an effective collateral network such that occlusion of one vessel, no, does not appreciably decrease cerebral blood flow. However, penetrating and parenchymal arterioles are long and largely unbranched. Penetrating arteries are there and parenchymal arterioles are there. Pial vessels, from that pial vessels, cerebrospinal fluid, penetrating arterioles, and then parenchymal arterioles. So penetrating and parenchymal arterioles, no, they are long and largely unbranched, so that occlusion of an individual arteriole results in significant reduction in flow and damage. So we have pial vessels, penetrating vessels, and parenchymal arterioles. Pial vessels, no, so they are They have a rich collateral network, but penetrating and parenchymal arterioles are long and largely unbranched. So occlusion of an individual arteriole, no? So this will result in significant reductions in flow and damage the surrounding local tissue. So despite differences in vessel architecture, all vessels in the brain have endothelium. Parenchymal arterioles, which have only one layer of circumferentially oriented smooth muscle, it is parenchymal arterioles. And despite differences in vessel architecture, all vessels in the brain have endothelium that is highly specialized and has barrier properties that are in some ways more similar to epithelium than endothelium in the periphery. So despite the differences in the vessel architecture, all vessels in the brain, okay, all vessels in the brain, they have endothelium, okay. So this endothelium, it is highly specialized and it has got barrier properties. So that are in some ways similar to epithelium, okay. So this is similar to epithelium than endothelium in the periphery. All vessels have endothelium, they are highly specialized and they have got barrier properties. So because of these unique barrier properties, so because all the vessels in the brain have endothelium and they have this unique barrier properties, they tightly regulate exchange of nutrients. They tightly regulate exchange of nutrients, solutes and water between the brain and the blood. So because of the unique barrier properties of the brain endothelium, they tightly regulate exchange of the nutrients, solutes and water. And the cerebral endothelium, it is known as the blood brain barrier. Okay, so the cerebral endothelium, it is known as the blood brain barrier. And the veins. So the cerebral venous system, it's a freely communicating and interconnected system. So comprised of dural sinuses and cerebral veins. Cerebral venous system, no, it is a freely communicating and interconnected system. So this cerebral venous system, no, it is composed of dural sinuses and cerebral veins. So what does it contain, cerebral venous system? It's interconnected dural sinuses and cerebral veins. So venous outflow from the cerebral hemispheres consist of two groups of valveless vein which allow for drainage. So outflow should be there from the cerebral hemispheres, no? It consists of two groups of valveless veins. Veins are valveless. So which allow for drainage. So which is the superficial cortical veins and deep or central veins. So we have superficial cortical veins and deep or central veins. So the superficial cortical veins are located in the pia mater on the surface of the cortex and drain the cerebral cortex. So the superficial cortical veins, no, they are located in the pia mater on the surface of the cortex and drain the cerebral cortex, and they also drain the subcortical white matter. So what is the superficial cortical vein draining? Surface of the cortex and also the subcortical white matter. The deep or central veins, no, they consist of subependymal veins, internal cerebral veins, basal vein and great vein of Galen. So the deep or central veins consist of subependymal veins. Apart from subependymal veins, there are also internal cerebral veins and basal vein and great vein of Galen. Great vein of Galen. So these are all the deep veins, great vein of Galen, subependymal vein, internal cerebral vein and basal vein. So these veins, they drain the brain's interior, including the deep white and gray matter surrounding the lateral and third ventricles of the basal cistern, and these anastomose with the cortical veins, and emptying into the superior sagittal sinus. So deep veins and superficial cortical veins are anastomosing. So the deep veins drain the brain's interior, including the deep white and gray matter, so which is surrounding the lateral and third ventricles or the basal system, and then they anastomose with the cortical veins. So these deep veins are anastomosing with the cortical veins, and this is emptying into the superior sagittal sinus. So venous outflow from the superior sagittal sinus and deep veins is directed via a confluence of sinuses towards the from superior sagittal sinus and deep veins, venous outflow is directed via a confluence of sinuses towards the sigmoid sinuses and the jugular veins. So towards the sigmoid sinus and then the jugular vein. So the cerebellum is drained primarily by two set of veins. So what is the drainage of the cerebellum? By two set of veins. So what are the two set of veins draining the cerebellum? Inferior cerebellar veins and the occipital sinuses. Cerebellum is drained by two set of veins. So what is the drainage of the cerebellum? The inferior cerebellar vein, okay, inferior cerebellar vein and occipital sinuses. Inferior cerebellar vein and occipital sinus drain the cerebellum, and brainstem is drained by the veins terminating in the inferior and transverse petrosal sinuses. What is the drainage of the brainstem? It's by the veins terminating in the inferior and transverse petrosal sinuses, inferior and transverse petrosal sinuses. So these diagrams were taken from Gray's Anatomy. So here this is, so we have the where are this pile arteries are there. So these are on the brain surface, okay. So they have perivascular nerves that give rise to penetrating arteries within the peripile artery endothelial cell. So this is a pile artery. So here are the perivascular nerves, and then there is also a Virchow-Robin space, and then so this is by glial end feet. So this is innervated by central pathways from locus ceruleus, raphe, nucleus, basalis, and ventral tegmental area, and parenchymal arterioles supply the cerebral microcirculation, known as the as penetrating arterioles become parenchymal arterioles within the brain neuropil. They become associated with neurons and astrocytes. So penetrating arterioles, no, they are becoming the parenchymal arterioles. So as they are becoming the parenchymal arterioles, they within the brain neuropil, they become associated with neurons and astrocytes. So parenchymal arterioles, they supply the cerebral microcirculation, known as the neurovascular unit. Superficial cortical veins and dural sinuses. So this is the sagittal sinus. And deep or central veins.